رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل واشهد ان لا اله الا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل واشهد ان سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى اله واصحابه والتابعين لهم باحسان الى يوم الدين اما بعد ان شاء الله تعالى I will be covering the kitab عمدة الاحكام written by عبد الغني عبد الواحد المقدسي رحمه الله. That's the book that I will be teaching today, inshallah ta'ala. And I will be doing the chapter, Kitab al-Siyam, the chapter of fasting. Before we start the book, the way that the scholars will do, and what they do, is that they speak about the biography of the book, and they also quickly speak about the book itself. So what I'm going to do, inshallah ta'ala, is I will speak about the author of the book. Who is the man who wrote this book? And the second thing I'm going to speak about, inshallah ta'ala, is about the book, Umdatul Ahkam. And then, inshallah ta'ala, we will do the hadith from Kitab al-Siyam. There are 32 hadith in Kitab al-Siyam. Inshallah, today we'll take 16, and tomorrow we'll take 16, inshallah ta'ala. The author of the kitab is Al-Hafidh Al-Imam Muhaddith Al-Islam Abu Muhammad Abdullah Abdul Ghani ibn Abdul Wahid ibn Ali ibn Surur ibn Rafi' ibn Hassan ibn Ja'far al-Jama'ili al-Dimashqi. His name is Kunya is Abu Muhammad. His Kunya is what? Abu Muhammad. This is going to come in the test. Exam. We're going to be asked these questions. What's his kunya? Abu Muhammad. What's his name? Abdul Ghani. Abdul Ghani is his name. Abdul Ghani ibn Abdul Wahid al-Maqdisi. Why is he called Maqdisi? He's attributed to what? Baytul Maqdis. Why is he called Maqdisi for? Because he's attributed to what? Baytul Maqdis. But why is he attributed to Baytul Maqdis when he wasn't born in Baytul Maqdis? And he wasn't in Baytul Maqdis. He was in a place called Jama'il. Jama'il is very close to Baytul Maqdis. So because it's very close to Baytul Maqdis, they ascribed him to Bayt al-Maqdis and they called him al-Maqdisi. His father, Abdul Ghani Abdul Wahid al-Maqdisi, his father's called Abdul Wahid, right? His father was from the early scholars who migrated, they left Bayt al-Maqdis. They left what? They left Bayt al-Maqdis. And the reason why they left is because there was a fitna that happened in Bayt al-Maqdis, that the family had to run away. The family, they had to run away. And so they ran away from Baytul Maqdis. And where did they run to? They ran to Damascus, Syria, right? They ran to Damascus. And at that place, his father and his family, they built a madrasa called Al-Madrasa Al-Umariyah. Has anyone heard of the madrasa? You never heard of madrasa al-Umariyya? Who's heard of madrasa al-Umariyya? You heard it. Where did you hear it? That's where I got the name from. They opened a madrasa called Al-Madrasa al-Umariyya. Madrasa al-Umariyya was an idea that came to me from where? From their story. They ran there and they built a madrasa called Madrasa al-Umariyya. The reason they called it Umariyya is because the Imam that ran there, Umar al-Maqdisi rahimahullah, they named it after him. He was at that time when he left Bayt al-Maqdis, Abd al-Ghani, when he left Bayt al-Maqdis, he was 10 years old. How old was he? He was 10 years old. Now let's talk about his family and his household that he grew up from. Abdul Ghani Abdul Wahid al-Maqdisi, like many other scholars, you will see, Nasha'a Nasha'atan Ilmiyya.
He grew up in a household where he was nurtured and cultivated upon knowledge. Rahimahullah. The knowledge-based household. His family are usra, ariqa, very rooted in knowledge. Abdul Ghani's family. His family, from generation to generation, they were known for knowledge. They were not only known for knowledge, but they were also known for salah. They were not only known for knowledge, but they were also known for their salah, their piety. Very pious family he was from. So he, at an early age, he was nurtured upon knowledge, early age. And there was a person who embarked in knowledge with. There was this man he was very close with, and he embarked in knowledge with him. His name is Ahmed ibn Muhammad ibn Qudama al-Maqdisi. Does anyone know who this person is? He didn't take knowledge from Ahmed ibn Muhammad ibn Qudama al-Maqdisi, but he studied under him. This was the first person after his father that he studied with, Ahmed ibn Muhammad ibn Qudama al-Maqdisi. That was the first person he studied with after his father. Okay, it wasn't somebody he studied with, it was somebody he studied from, that he took knowledge from. We're going to see who this man is, Ahmed ibn Muhammad ibn Qudama al-Maqdisi. Does anyone know the author of the kitab al-Mughni? Put your hand up if you've heard the kitab al-Mughni in fiqh. You've heard about it, al-Mughni in fiqh? That's the father of that author. We're going to see later, inshallah ta'ala. So let me repeat one more time what I said. What's the author of this name, the book? Abdul Ghani is his name. What's his kunya? Abu Muhammad. What's his father's name? Abdul Wahid. Where was he born? He was born in a place called? Jama'il. Jama'il is close to where? It's very close to? Baytul Maqdis. Very good. Where did they travel to? They traveled to? Dimashq. Okay. Who did he take knowledge from after his father? Ahmed ibn Muhammad ibn Qudama. Has everyone got that information? Very good. Now we're going to go into the journeys that the author did. He traveled. Are we all together, brothers? You have to travel to seek knowledge. It's very important to travel to seek knowledge. He traveled, rahimahullah, to seek knowledge, and this is something that the early scholars used to do. They used to travel. They used to go out of their house, and they would go to travel to seek knowledge. Write this down. It's very important information for you to write down. He traveled to many places, rahimahullah. I'm going to state some of the places that he went to. He went to Baghdad. Where did he go to? Baghdad. Who did he take knowledge from in Baghdad? Abdul Qadir al-Jailani. When he went to Baghdad, who did he take from? He took from him. He met him and he took knowledge from him. Who was with him when he went to seek knowledge from Abdul Qadir al-Jailani? Remember, it's good to accompany someone. If you want to travel, it's good to travel with someone. He traveled with Muwaffaquddin ibn Qudama. Muwaffaquddin ibn Qudama is the author of the Kitab al-Mughni. He's the son of the first teacher of Abdul Ghani after his father. Am I making sense? Or is there a language barrier? Who was his first teacher? Abdul Ghani. His father, right? Yeah. And then after that? Ahmed ibn Muhammad ibn Qudama is the father of Muwaffaquddin ibn Qudama. That's the son. Muwaffaquddin ibn Qudama is the son. He's the author of the Kitab al-Mughni. Does that make sense? Brothers, does it make sense? Am I going too fast?
No.
Yeah?
Keep going,
huh? Who thinks I'm going too fast? Put your hand up, don't worry. If you feel like I'm going too fast. I'm used to going fast. Okay, I'll do it slowly again. Abdul Ghani Abdul Wahid al-Maqdisi, he took knowledge from his father. When he took knowledge from his father, he also took knowledge from Ahmed Ahmed ibn Muhammad ibn Qudama al-Maqdisi. Who died in the year 558. That Ahmed ibn Muhammad ibn Qudama al-Maqdisi died in the year 558. Okay, that was his first teacher after his father. Does that make sense? Now, Ahmed is the father of a great imam. He's the father of a what? A great imam. He's the father of one powerful imam. One of the greatest imam of the Hanbali madhab. Who is he? Everyone knows, generally knows Ibn Qudama. This is the father of Muwaffaquddin. Are we all together, brothers? Who's the father, who's the son? Muwaffaquddin is the son. Ahmed ibn Muhammad is the father. So the son's name is actually called what? Muwaffaquddin is a nickname, it's a laqab. His actual name is Abdullah ibn Ahmed ibn Muhammad ibn Qudama al-Maqdisi. Huh? Was that slow? Muwaffaquddin's name, just learn it, Muwaffaquddin, okay? His name is Abdullah. And Ahmed after all of that. Does that make sense? Don't worry, the name calling, it will stop soon, inshallah. When we get in the book, we're not going to be saying names. But I really want you to know the author. I have a way, when I teach, I make sure that the person studies the author and who he is. Okay? Why am I mentioning this? Because he traveled with his cousin. They are cousins. Muwaffaquddin and the author of this book, Abdul Ghani, are cousins. They are what? You know what cousins are? Yeah? You guys know what cousins are? It means both of their fathers were brothers. Abdul Ghani's father and Muwaffaquddin's father were brothers. So they traveled together. When they traveled together and they went to Baghdad, what should they say about that? You guys say Iraq or Iraq? You say Iraq. Okay, pay attention here. Let's focus. They went to Baghdad. Abdul Ghani, he leaned towards Hadith. And ilm al-rijal and chain of narration and Hadith and science. Muwaffaquddin, where did he lean towards? Muwaffaquddin, he leaned towards, you all know what it means, right? He turned towards what? Fiqh. Muwaffaquddin, fiqh ul-ahli. Muwaffaquddin, fiqh ul-ahli. Abdul Ghani ibn ul-ahli, Hadith, ul-ulum. Must not be straight? Should I do it both? Should I do it smart in English? Yeah, both? Okay, I'll do it both. Inshallah. I hope I don't do a mistake in Somali. So when they went to Iraq, Abdul Ghani Hadith and Muwaffaquddin Fiqh. And they were very close cousins. I'll go together. I'll be Sahib Ohayan, Ilmi and Sifanis, Surah Barthen. Let's do that. Walidarika, because of that, Muwaffaquddin, he wrote one of the biggest pieces of work in fiqh. Muwaffaquddin, who wrote a kitab, all the way of fiqh al Hanbali, al-Mughni. The name of the book is? Mughni. Sharah al-Muhayyutai, Kitab ka Mukhtasar al-Khiraki. Ayu Sharah. Kitab ka al-Mughni, it's an explanation of what? Mukhtasar al-Khiraki. Abdul Ghani na Kitab ka al-Qura Sagana. Kitab wain fi ilm al-Hadith. Kitab wain wa ilm al-Hadith. Ukuma ra'abay al-Kamal fi ma'rifati asma'i al-Rijal. Al-Kamal في معرفة أسماء الرجال something like that. حقوق الكتاب كتاب حقوق رواة البخاري ومسلم لمن كبخاري وجهه يدوم كبخاري كجرو أسانيد حديثة القصة الصعري رجلا رجلا المهدوء قريب كتاب عن الكمال في معرفة الرجال. What he did was, in this kitab, he specified it with the narrators of Bukhari and Muslim, their narrators. The narrators of Bukhari and Muslim, the men that are in Sahih Bukhari, Sahih Muslim, also in all of the works of Bukhari and the works of Muslim, all of their narrators, he wrote a book in there. Abdul Ghani. So he's a great imam. Allah Ta'ala subhanahu wa ta'ala shaykh ayah. صفة على رفع بصماء. عبد الغني بن حرب بعض الصفات. Some of his characteristics. We're going to now speak about the characteristics of عبد الغني. صفات كيس محاكم الهاي. وحال الشيخ صفات كيس اللي كمين هاي. إنو أهاي قف آل وخلاق بنا. From the characteristics that were mentioned regarding him is that he had very good manners. High etiquette, رحمه الله. والرشا يعين للآد أخلاق ذا من يوحى وحال الوتي المامي إنه أحايق في حفظ بغل. He was said to be someone who had strong memorization رحمه الله سلوك وحال الوتي المامي إن صفات كسائك من أهيد محاربة البدع وحيا لها دين تلوسو دريو. You know that word? وحيالها دين المصور ترى أيوه حسو بجر ولد لالجر. He used to fight with the newly invented issues. Anything that was added to the religion, عبد الغني would fight against it. رحمه الله. وحان الوية قيمة إنو أهاي قف أدت الله أمره ونكا حمانتنا دت وأبتك جري حمانتنا وأبتكجر. He used to call the people to good and he would prohibit them from evil. That was his characteristics. فكان لا يرى منكرا وحال الشيء منكر بأكجر. He would never see an evil. إلا غيره. إلا وحسو ديجر مقعنت زبو بدره. He would try his hardest to change him with his hand. هدوس الأولين عرب وكوشي جري. He would speak about it with his tongue. وحال لو الشيء إنو هاي وكان لا تأخذه في الله لوم تلائمه. قف ايدو ايدو ما كان بخيجن قف وحكا الشهدو ما كان جعل المسال ما كان لا يخاف في الله لوم التلائم. The blame, he never was scared of the blame of the blamers. What would the people say about him? From his characteristics was also وقوة شخصيته. He had great personality. He had strong personality. شخصيته تدنمت 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 ولا يسموها قال من الله ولا تتذكر تنمو الحيات والسرسو وحولها قف أد الجيس. He was a very courageous man, very brave man رحمه الله. From his characteristics was متواضع. He was a very humble person. قف أد متواضع الحيات متواضع الحيات سمع. You know what متواضع is, right? Humble. وحلو الشيء إنه حقف كرم يوجود حبيبه. He used to give. He used to, that's the type of person he was. رحمه الله رحمة واسعة. أرديد وحوله جل. The people who used to teach, the people who he would teach, he would give to them. If they couldn't come to their classes because of financial problems, he would give them money behind it. أرديد سواء قصة لكي سجري. لعب سجري. حاجد يلبك هيسوي وإماجل وشير جلين وحوق وكر وفوق بجل. رحمه الله. سدح ميلو داري. He had three boys. He had three boys. محمد عبد الله عبد الرحمن. سدح رسول الله. آذنه وقف كرجلي. آذنه إلى رجل. Some of the characteristics of students of knowledge and also scholars, sometimes they forsake their children. That's one of the characteristics. الموضك موحى يعني. الموضك مريك سيادة العالم. صح؟ وكاركترستيكس معروفة. Sometimes it's not due to the sheikh not trying, but it just is Shaytan would try hardest to the sheikh of the local masjid, you know, to misguide his son. That's what Shaytan would try to do, right? Imam Malik, what was said about him, وحيالا الإمام مالك الشيخ الحكمي وحالي اللي درسي انتو بهنا يوم ويبتي سدلالي وعيالي ويقول لك إمام مالك مساجد تبقى نانكي سوف بيالي جدا سولي جري هذي علمي ووحي السيسيو أهاري أما هو أهالا هاي عنقي علم وسيلة هاي باكاس إن الله يهدي ما يشاء إمام مالك والي would give a lesson. They said that his son would be playing outside while he's teaching. While he was teaching, and he used to say, if knowledge was something that was given, if it was something that was, I would have given it to my son. But look, this one. The masjid is full. People would come to Imam Malik, يُضْرَبُ إِلَيْهِ أَكْبَادُ الْإِبْنِ. People come to him from all over the world to take knowledge from Imam Malik. And his own son would not benefit from him. That's the thing. مركّة الإمام عبد الغني عبد الواحد المقدسي وحالي he used to really care about his children. We wish that. And the way that he used to care with them is, he used to say to them, come with me to seek knowledge. But with the ما شاء الله يعلمي أهو بيجري علمي أخي جري وحموسي جري. ولذلك his son Muhammad and Abdullah, both of them, they traveled with him to Isfahan. He used to take care of their knowledge and their studying. وإراعين كل أصبهان لذلك. أما أصبهان, that is part of where? Iran. Part of Iran. أصبهان سبحان, part of Iran. Once upon a time, Iran was أرض التوحيد والسنة. Once upon a time, Iran used to be a land where the Tawheed and the Sunnah would be studied and would be taught. Great scholars came from it, like Abu Hatim Ar-Raziyu. Ar-Razi is from where? Ar-Ray. And the scholars, they say, Ar-Raziyu Khilafu Al-Qiyas. Because they brought extra za and what? That's just Sama'ah, that's how it is. Ar-Razi. Ar-Ray is a place in Iran. Right now, I think Ar-Ray falls in Tehran, the capital. Tehran. Once upon a time, Iran used to be what? Scholars of the Sunnah used to come out from it. And today, who comes out from it? Rawafid and Shia come out from it. They come out of it. It's taught in Abu Bakr and Umar. Now we're going to talk about some of his teachers. We mentioned already his main teacher was the father of Muwaffaquddin ibn Qudama, Ahmed ibn Muhammad ibn Qudama al-Maqdisi, was his first teacher after his father. There were also women who taught him. Abd al-Ghani had women that he took knowledge from. Because those times women were very strong in their knowledge. They had ilm, they had ahadith and riwayat and asanid, like Karima. Karima, she was one of the ruwat of Bukhari of her time. She never got married. Waited, Mughu Sinaiti, Muhammad Sina. Mughu Sinaiti. She never got married. Muhammad Sinaiti, a hadith in the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. She used to narrate the hadith of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Makwa from Sijr Tahiri, Walo Imajir Mecha. Kof Kasta Imajir. رجالا ونساء. لمن كان لها كل واحد من له من قمتها. And they would sit and she would narrate ahadith. Ahadith تنمي وشريفة. أسانيد كقادة وخيجة. They used to change from her. مقو سنيد. So that was one of his, without those teachers he had were many. His teachers, they said that he reached more than 100. More than 100 teachers. His students are many. From them is Muhammad ibn Ahmed ibn Qudama al-Maqdisi, his cousin. The one that wrote Al-Mughni was one of his students. He took hadith from him. Also, from his students is Al-Hafidh Abdul Azim al-Mundiri. Hafidh al-Mundiri, you know him? The author of the kitab, Al-Targhib wa Tarhib. He's one of the students of Abdul Ghani Abdul Wahid al-Maqdisi. From his students is Abdul Qadir Ibn Abdillah al-Rahawiri was one of his students. And I'm going to leave it there, inshallah, which is Abdul Ghani. He traveled. First of all, Abdul Ghani's aqidah is aqidah to Ahlul Sunnah. He was Salafiyul aqidah. His aqidah was aqidah to Ahlul Sunnah. Okay? Nasir al-Sunnah. He used to defend the Sunnah. Sunnah that adhu didari jirayu difa'u. مجع عليه السنة النبي للوعياء. Are we all together, brothers? ساسوها قابعا للبدع بدع الود ديجل ودراعج الموقر للبدع قوالا بالحق كنت شيء هذا كنت ليش سيد شوف عبد الغني that's the type of person he was and because of that he got harmed لذلك فقد ابتلي بأداء أهل البدع the people of innovation were different the innovators they harmed him what different the brother in quest again I'm going to mention a couple of stories that happened to him. See the Marty Baker in time. I share it around. We have saw that he came to Asbahan. Abdul Ghani came to the land Asbahan. He came, rahimahullah. But then Asbahan, when he came into the land of Asbahan, he saw a kitab called Ma'rifatul Sahaba. Kitab here, the Ma'rifatul Sahaba, al-Waqi. Kitab here, the Waqi, Abu Nu'aym al-Asbahan, al-Waqi. Kitab QRK, Abdul Ghani, he saw the book and he read it. He saw this kitab, what was the name of the book? Ma'rifatul Sahaba, the book was called. Abdul Ghani, Kitab QRK, Ishamuku Sasu Sari, Akhirnuku Bilal. He straight to him, as soon as he saw it, he started to read it. Am I making sense? Is my Somali clear? Yeah? Crystal clear, Swana. So as soon as he saw the book, he corrected the places he thought that were wrong in the book. Abdul Ghani Murku Aki Kitaki, Kalalad Badan Aki Kitab Lehju. Kitab Yuhuku Aki, Kalalad Badan. Because in Husubi, he saw many mistakes. 290 mistakes he saw. Makkalalu Aki, Labokol Sarash and Kalalalu Aki. Labokol Yo? يصل عشان قلت أن يكتب قوارك مركز سومركو أركي he started to write a response to those mistakes عروحين قلالات كانوا إلا برالوجيا these mistakes need to be pointed out he should have done that I mean he should have done that but the consequences weren't good there were a family who were known as the بيتو الخجنديو عبد اللطيف الخجندي من ميلاده. They were known as the family of Khujandi. Khujandi at Egypt. Khujandiyo. عبد اللطيف الخجندي. بيت الخجندي at Egypt. They were عائلة أشعرية. They were أشعري family. That is the آية. مركو كتابكي بالله when he started to point out the mistakes in his book. Abdul Ghani, they got angry because they were fanatic towards Abu Nu'aym. They loved him excessively. So they called for his killing. They went to the leader. You know what it means قرط الله داري هذا خارجي خارجي نحن نقول له قبل كان خارجي متخاني you guys know what خارجي means هذا خارجي نكام على الوضع بنون إذا عيام يا it means bring him to an end right so kill him so what did عبد الغني do he left أصبهان متخفيا he hid and left أصبهان they call him off for his killing and he's so he hid رحمه الله وقوله مدالي قدمها هذين اللي ضعيتها مدالي قبها وعربي عبد الغني the second story is that happened to him was he came to Mosul where's Mosul? Mosul is in where? Is in Iraq may Allah make the affairs and situation of Iraq better inshallah when he went there he had of a book known as Al-Du'afa lil-Uqaydi. Kitab al-Hurma qalayli ilahadu Al-Du'afa lil-Uqaydi. Kitab al-Du'afa na wa ha-kujiru inside this book is Huwada, the narrators of hadith who are weak. He heard of this book, Abdul Ghani. Kitab al-Kasru Muqaydi, he heard of this book. When he heard of this book, what did he do? He said, I'm going to teach him. And he wants to teach the people who these narrators are, their names, and etc. And of course, to know who they are so you don't confuse them in the narrations. Like in who are one of the people who were criticized in that book? Abu Hanifa. Abu Hanifa has been criticized in that book. Are we all together, brothers? And Abu Hanifa Mu'iyya wa imam min a'immat al-kibar. He's one of the great imams, Abu Hanifa, sah? Rahimahullah wa rahmatullah wa sallam. So what he did, Abdul Ghani, is he started to read the book. When he started to read, the Hanafis were angry. They got very angry with him. And again, they wanted to kill him. And Al-Burhan ibn al-Banni nearly ran. Al-Burhan ibn al-Banni nearly ran. He found a way to take him out of the city. He found a way to save him. Anyways, the point I'm trying to come to is, this great imam was harmed. And he was scared for his life at one point. And today, here he is, we have his book, Umdatul Ahkam, right? Abdul Ghani, he died from an illness in the month of Shahr Rabi' al-Awwal. When the month was Rabi' al-Awwal, he became ill, excessively. And the year was 600 Hijriah. He became very ill, and this illness, it stopped him from speaking and from standing. جِرُوحَا قُطْعَ عَلَيْ آلِ اُدَّرَمْ هَذَا الْكِبَانُ أَوُّ رِوَايِي وَإِسْتَاغِي وَاحَدِ إِسْتَاغِي أَدْوِيسِ هم استاغوا وحبه مش شيء كده هذا هذا مني كده مرقوح عبا هذا وشاري جلس هذا إيه كان مني جلس هذا الكبان أكبر ومن إستاغي وايي رحمه الله تعالى كل الطب and this was 16 يوما 16 days لحية تبنى لما يحبوك سيسي The duration of the illness was for 60 days. Into Siriti Sisamai, while he was on his deathbed, he couldn't talk and he couldn't stand. Like what he would do is, his children would come and they would read his hadiths on him. Because he had ijazat and marwiyat and riwayat. So they would read on him and he would nod his head when they finished each hadith. And we were together. If they did a mistake, he would stop them and he would nod his head. And they will repeat the hadith, and when they read it correctly, he will say this. He can't talk. Rahimahullah wa rahmatan wasi'a. He died in Egypt on Monday, on the 23rd of Rabi' al-Awwal, when the year, the Islamic calendar was 600 Hijriah. Here we are today, 600 Hijriah. Here we are today, inshallah ta'ala, studying his works. This book that we're going to take is called Umdatul Ahkam by him, the author. The reason I chose this book is because all of the hadith in this book is what? As-Sahih. So my lesson is better than Abu Taymiyyah's lesson. Because Abu Taymiyyah's book is not the most, it hasn't got all of the authentic hadith in there. So who's better? My class is going to be better. Ulum al-Maram, what does it have? It's got weak narrations. So I chose wisely which book I'm going to teach. Umdatul Ahkam, it has no weak narrations in it. There are some places where the author does a mistake here or there, like in the hadiths are all authentic. Does that make sense? Why are they all authentic? Because nearly all of the hadiths here are what Bukhari and Muslim agreed upon. It's mutafakun alayhi. You all know Bukhari. Put your hand up if you don't know who Bukhari is. Alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah. You all know who Muslim is, right?
All of them.
All of the Muslims. You all know who Muslim is, right? How many people is Muslim? You all know who Muslim is, right? One person. Those two, when they agree on a hadith, what's it called? Yeah, what's the difference between mutafaqun alayhi and rawahu al-Bukhari Muslim? Is there a difference? Yeah? Yeah, there is a difference. Rawahu al-Bukhari Muslim and mutafaqun alayhi, there is a difference. We'll leave for another day. So, the ahadith which are in Bukhari Muslim are the most authentic. they are the what? They are the most authentic. وأول من ألف وأول من صنف في الصحيح محمد وخص بالترجيح ومسلم بعد وبعض الغرب مع أبي علي فضلوا ولو نفع ولم يعماه ولكن قلما عند ابن الأخرم منه قد فاتهما ورد لكن قال يحيى البرو لم يفوت الخمسة إلا ننزل وفيما فيه لقول جعفي أحفظ منه عشر ألف أنف. الإمام البخاري, his book is the most authentic book after the book of who? Allah, book of Allah Azza wa Jalla. After the book of Allah, which one is most authentic? Kitab ya usah ihsan ba'da kitab illahi, kitab illahi kitab. Bukhari ya usah ihsan zaman, ya usah ihsan. But the Muslim ya Bukhari ya fi'an. Which one is better, Bukhari or Muslim? No, wrong. Which one is better, Bukhari or Muslim? No. What's better is Bukhari and Muslim. Drop both. What's better? Bukhari and Muslim and not both. What do I mean by that? It's confusing, huh? Bukhari and Muslim, not both. Why? Bukhari is better in authenticity and Muslim is better in organization. Does that make sense? Who's better in authenticity? Bukhari is better than Muslim. Bukhari is more authentic hadith. Are we all together? But who's better in the way he organized his book? Muslim is better in organization. Or Muslim kitab is a wahabi sayyihai, warrati banihai. Qafkar wa inu had the kitab hibdi yinu wa inu ada. شوش سكروا عليه لقد تشاجر قوم في البخاري ومسلم فوقالوا بأي دليل تقدموا لقد فاق البخاري صحة كما قد فاق المسلم صحة يا في عام which one is better بخاري عن مسلم بخاري from one angle a Muslim from another angle anyways this book is بخاري عن. Many people do not know that there's two Undatul Ahkam. Some of you are shocked now, right? There's two Undatul Ahkam that are authored and published, they're out there. Did you guys know that? Put your hand up if you didn't know. And Allah knows, obviously. There's Undatul Ahkam al-Sughra and there's Kubra. Now go together, brothers. The Sughra is the one we're doing right now. There's a small one, but it is better, baby. There's a big one and there's a small Umdatul Ahkam. The Kubra has 900 and something hadith. The Kubra has how many hadith? Salal Bukul Yawah. That's Mata Wahaki Waskiriya. There's not much people who explain that book. So far, in my humble opinion, the only person I saw that explained it and it's published today is a Sheikh called Hamid Uthman from Kuwait. He explained it. You explain the big one. Yeah, are you with me? The majority of the scholars, they just explain this one. Kanwa Suwa is the baby one. This is the one with the majority of us. When everybody says Umdat al-Ahkam, Umdat al-Ithlaq, they mean this one. Are you with me, brothers? There's a lot of things I wanted to say about Umdat al-Ahkam, a bit about it, but we don't have much time. I've only been given 4 hours to teach 32 hadiths. So the plan is as follows. The plan is as follows. I'm going to mention the hadith. Straight after the hadith, all I'm going to do is I'm going to mention the fiqh, the benefits that we can take from the hadith. I'm going to say 1, 2, 3, 4. And then we're going to move to second hadith. Wahakada. If the author did something wrong, maybe in the wording or something, I'll point that out. Is that easy for everyone to understand? That's the way we will finish quickly. Does everyone understand? I'm gonna, inshallah ta'ala, I'm gonna read Arabic. The brother is gonna read, what's your name? Sulaiman is gonna read the English for us, inshallah ta'ala, the English. Who's gonna read the Somali for us?
Adnan, so.
Adnan, that's good. كتاب الصيام. What does صيام mean لغة؟ What does fasting mean in the Arabic language? يا الآن غير. Let's make it interactive. Who knows fasting? Fasting is what? Fasting لغة in the Arabic language, what does it mean? It means to withhold. الإمساك, write it down if you can write Arabic. الإمساك is what it means in the Arabic language. الصوم, الصيام لغة is what? الإمساك. إمساك محل غير جيدة. محل غير جيدة. إن قفك قوة إسئلالي وحد إسئلالي يوم. إسئلالي to restrain, to refrain from something. Yeah. الإمساك means what? كجوهد. كجوهد. إسئلالي. إسكحائنة وحد إسكحي سيدو. إسكحائنة سيدو. So many. I don't know. I'm trying to look for words to translate it. Am I making? Have I found the right word for it? Al-imsak is withhold. That's what Abu Ubaida, rahimahullah, mentioned in his kitab Majaz al-Quran. And he's one of the first people to point that out, rahimahullah ta'ala. So, qafka, inu iska hayo, am iska? Yeah? Fa'in ma'am.
Yeah?
Allah, I don't know the lahja. It's cool, it's got different. Yeah, yeah, I don't know what it's. You have to restrain, refrain from. To refrain can be anything in the language. Pay attention, this is the important thing. In the language, you're refraining from any and everything. If I say I'm not going to talk to you, it's a siyam in the language. It's mutlaqul imsak. It's unrestricted refraining. Does that make sense? Any and everything you can withhold yourself from it. وَحَكَسْتَ أَتْسْكِ إِلَىٰ لِسِلُوتِ الْمِسْرِ سِيَامُ صَوَسْكَرَ وَحَلَا كَمِتْعَ قَوْلُهُ تَعَالَى فَقُولِ إِنِّي نَذَرْتُ فَقُولِ إِنِّي نَذَرْتُ لِلرَّحْمَنِ صَوْمًا فَلَمْ أُكَلِّمَ الْيَوْمَ نسيها مريم محللة واز مريم سيليها إني نذرت للرحمن صوما إلهي طلنا لك عليه نذرت نذر علي لك طلنا أن الله لك عليه I went I have a covenant and an oath with Allah عز وجل which is what إني نذرت للرحمن صوما لأن أنا fast fasting here means I'm a refraining what did she say after that إني نذرت للرحمن صوما فلن أكلم اليوم ما انتملها لدونها إنسيا قفبا بعد ما رحل أن نجرته I'm not going to talk to anyone She said, "Sawman," and she said, "I'm not going to talk to anyone." So, saw in the language means to refrain from any and everything. Are we all together, brothers? So, if you meet a brother and you don't like him, and he invites you over to his house, you should like to be a Muslim, but you don't want to go to him to his house, and he's begging you, please come, and you say, "I'm fasting." What fasting can you be talking to about?
From the phone.
Yeah, you can. It can be mutlaq or imsak. You're withholding from any and everything. From you going to your house, anything. In the language, fasting is different to what it means in the Sharia. Sharia means staying away from particular things. In the Sharia, is al imsak bi niyyah. It is to intentionally stay away from the mufaddalat. Mufaddalat, what is it? We're going to talk about that. من شخص مخصوص في وقت مخصوص that's what it is. Fasting in the Sharia means to withhold from the things that can break your fasting from a particular person at a particular time. So I'm going to have a الإمساك قفك إنه تسك إلى أن يسك نورا عن المفطرات وحيا لها صومك جبنا يوم بنية لكن نية وجهه With an intention, you have to do it. من شخص مخصوص from a particular person. Not everybody has to fast. في وقت مخصوص على particular time that you fast. You can't say like the non-Muslims. Some of them they say I'm fasting at night, but they're sleeping. At night they fast. Are you together? No. Fast. When is it fasting? When is fasting? من طلوع الفجر إلى غروب الشمس. Good. When was the fasting made obligatory? Yeah? That's a mistake. من طلوع الفجر إلى غروب الشمس. When was the fasting made obligatory? Does anyone know here when it was made obligatory? In Medina. What year? Gormas sunk in the wajib. Ya ilahi. Ya ilahi. Ya ilahi. Ya ilahi. When was fasting made obligatory? Second year, barakallahu fiik. السنة الثانية من الهجرة. بالإجماع. Ibn Taymiyyah ulama بالإجماع. By consensus. That was the second year. Before that, they never used to fast. An obligatory fasting. The fasting, like it became obligatory, tadrijiyan. Gradually, okay, by the way. But we're never going to that. What are the benefits of fasting? Hey, Qurta. I'm going to mention four benefits of fasting. أَفَّرْ فَائِذُ وَكُجِّرُ إِلَّا الصَّوْمُ. Four benefits that are in fasting. Number one, the fasting is مِنْ أَكْبَرِ الْعَوْمِ عَلَى تَقْوَى اللَّهِ تَعَالَى. It is one of the greatest things that help you to attain piety. Fasting is from one of the greatest things to attain taqwa. Fasting, brothers, صَوْمُكَ وجدتك جدك وسهلا ولفرد اوقفك كان سكر وكحسلك رب تقول الله عز وجل عبسي الله يا ابعوا يا ايها الذين امنوا كتب عليكم الصيام كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم ها سوف تقوى كان لعلكم تتقون فاستن بيز اباوت تقوى we know that because of that ayah ولذلك when a person is fasting taqwa comes about from it. Number two, the second benefit, فَإِذَا دَرَبَاتَ وَكُجِرْتَ الصَّمْكَ is التَّعَبُدُ لِلَّهِ تَعَالَى بِتَرْكِ شَهَوَاتِ النَّفْسِ وَمَأْلُوفَاتِهَا. You're leaving off your desires. Fasting is a way to leave off your desires. صَمْكَ فَإِذَا كُجِرْتَ وَحَوَايَ أَمَا كَمِدْعَى قَفْكَ وَفْرُوكَ تَيْكَرَى شَهَوَاتِ النَّفْسِ سُحِيكَ أَسْعَى نفتعل واحد رغبات تجد طويل طاهد واحد تجد fasting can benefit. مثلا if a brother is not married and he has shahwa in him, maybe صلى الله عليه وسلم advise him. If you've got desires and you're single and the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said يا معشر الشباب من استطاع منكم الباءة فليتزوج. What did he say? Pursue, marry. But your miskin Somali brother, you can't get married. You're struggling. You don't have the money to get married. It's not looking good for you. There's no light there in that tunnel. One of our center, one squeeze the money. So what do you do? فعليك بالصوم. فعليك بالصوم. Just fast. صوم كرب الإمام. What would you do? فإنه أغض للبصر. Your eyesight also أعى. Martin, are you going to think about the opposite gender? أو ما تعطيك في الكنيسة. When you fast, the benefits were how are you? You can't think of the opposite gender. You're thinking about burger, chicken, pizza, fried chicken. You know, رب للبصر وأحسن للفرج. Number three. الصوم تربية للإرادة. Fasting is one of the ways to attain self-discipline. Oh, pay attention to that. Fasting is one of the ways to attain self-discipline. صَوْمُكَ وَحَاكُ جِرُ نَفْضُلَ تَرْبِيَيْنَا يُو تَرْبِيَةُ النَّفْسِ نَفْتِ يُو self-discipline وحواي تَرْبِيَةُ النَّفْسِ قَفْتِ نَفْتِ شُو تَرْبِيَيْنَا. Imagine this, brothers. You're hungry. You're thirsty. You can see water. You're like, oh, I want to drink it. But guess what? No, I'm not going to do it. Self-discipline, right? Are we all together, brothers? You want to do so many haram things, you're like, you know what, I can't do it because I'm fasting. The fourth benefit it has, and that's a side benefit. That's not why we fast, by the way. Some people, they bring this to the first and they mention it, which is there are health benefits in it. But do we fast because there are health benefits in it? Yeah. Prophet Ruqliya, what I saw, what Allah saw, and had that. That's what I nafti. I think very much. Why your eyes? What the money is that here? I can't survive. You hear the people say like that. Fast, you're gonna get a little waste, and mashallah, you're gonna have six packs in your ears. Subhanallah. And the whole deen, wallahi, some people, subhanallah, the way that they talk, they turn the religion into. They took away the spirituality out of it, and they made the whole religion. You pray. It's an exercise. You do rukur. It's an exercise. Your back is straight. You know, it's good for your back. It's good for your thighs. It's good for your cheeks. It's good for everything. Are we all together, brothers? No. Our religion, the ibadat, it has a spiritual side. Are we all together? It has a spiritual side. Had the makaw, afar tasfa, you know, those four benefits I mentioned, everyone written it.
What was the fourth one?
Yeah, what was the fourth one? It has health benefits. Ah, for what? For sunni, for what? Sahiya, there's a lot of health benefits in there. So, man, there is a lot of health benefits in it. And another benefit I read was that for a person to leave any addiction, are we all together? Is everybody paying attention here? To leave off addiction. To leave off what? To leave off addiction. Whatever type of addiction is, the scholars, they say it takes how many days? They said 1 month. 1 month a person can leave any addiction that they have. Whatever addiction it is. You can leave it in how many days? Fasting is how many? No, it's a month. I didn't say 29 or I didn't say 30. I said a month. So yeah, let's start the hadith, inshallah. A hadith at the Karina. Hello, nigga. 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 Let me read the hadith. The hadith is, everyone has to have the notes if they, inshallah ta'ala. عن أبي هريرة رضي الله تعالى عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لا تقدموا رمضان بصوم يوم ولا يومين إلا رجل كان يصوم صوما فليصومه.
Do not fast for a day or two ahead of Ramadan except for the one who used to fast beforehand, then he can fast.
Three things we take from this hadith. How many benefits do we take from this hadith? Three benefits. Number one, you are not allowed to fast before the entering of Ramadan. 1 or 2 days. You are not allowed to fast before Ramadan, yawman aw bi yawmayni, 1 or 2 days before it. So you can fast more than that. 3 days before Ramadan you can, based on this hadith. Lakin you're not allowed to fast 2 or 1 day before Ramadan. No. Are we all together, brothers? Whether your intention is, I am doing this to be on the safe side, I might miss Ramadan, I'm scared, they could have got it wrong, I just want to be on the safe side, so I'm going to start fasting early. No, you're not. Are you with me what I'm saying? Some people say, Ali was ilali no ya, ha wa ha wa ra'in an son ki it san ilafin, mani yalom ma las kisi so man la'alla. La'alla la ra'alla is khinsu. Yeah? Yom or Yom Maini, you're not allowed to fast 1 or 2 days before. The second one, I think your question is going to come up in the second part. There's an exception. Yustathna min dalika, lakin wahab do an exception. There's an exception for this. Oh, ma'ayta exception kahiya. The exception here is, man kana lahu aada. There's a person who used to have a nose. Every Monday and Thursday, he used to fast way before Ramadan came, he always was a Monday and Thursday faster. Monday is your Thursday, kiss to us from here. But after. Are we all clear about this? He's a person who's known to fast Mondays and Thursdays. Ma'roof. They call him the Monday and Thursday brother. He's ma'roof. He's known for it. Okay? That's how he's known. He can fast even if it falls one day, Monday or 2 days before Ramadan. Ramadan is on a Saturday and Thursday came. He's allowed to fast. No problem. Why? Because he used to do this before Ramadan came. But if I'm not sure, I said, I love that Sabi. Number three. Number three. I mentioned the first one was the hadith prohibits fasting 1 or 2 days before its entering. That was the first point. What was that? The second point was, there is an exception. The second one is, there is an exception for the person who used to fast Mondays and Thursdays. Or he used to fast 1 day off, 1 day on. 1 day off, 1 day on. Like, كان يصوم يوما ويفطر يوما. Fasting of Dawood. And apparently, it hit a day before Ramadan. Okay? That's an exception. Of course, Allah has called some kind of carrying your fasting. There's nothing upon you. Point number three. Some of the scholars, they researched. Some of the scholars, what did they do? They researched. Why did the Sharia prohibit fasting a day or two before Ramadan? Why? Some of the scholars, remember قال أبرك بحري قبل researching قبل planning what's the reason? What's the hikmah behind it? And they came to this conclusion. This is their analyzation. Remember, in the Sharia, there is a illa which is called illa mansusa and illa which is mustanbata. Sometimes the Sharia tells you why it prohibits something. It will say to you, the reason why this is haram is because it's going to intoxicate you. Do we know why khamr is haram? Why is khamr haram? Because of iskar. How do you know that it was prohibited because of intoxication? Nabi Muhammad said it. Nabi Muhammad clearly wa'uri. Iskar. He used that word. Nabi Ashari. Wa illa mansusa. Mansusa means what? It was stated by the messenger. Wa al-washa wa al-washa'i sabat al-lodi day. I'm not 51 shayai. Illa di lodi the khamri of Madhani. Do you know why the khamr was in haram? Because the Prophet stated. Sometimes the Sharia prohibits something, we don't know what it is. The fuck halodi day. Why was the pig made haram? Do you all know what a dofar is? Dofar means why is the pig made haram? Yeah? Haywana karu'ula. Kashin karu'ula. Yeah? Why was it made haram the dofar? وورا وورا سخمتي ها وورا صح طيب هي لا حد لا يا حد انت اسوق هذا هي هيدي كيسه جيرمز كمان هيدي كيسه جيرمز كمان بقى هذا ما في اشكال ويبينا اد فهم المساله هذه واحده لي وورا هذه واحده لي جانس ما كنت بقول It's probably pay attention. Hadid dofar in the laboratory. The brother here, he said the pig and swine was made haram because it's not bad. And this brother said, because the germs doesn't leave the system. Okay, pay attention. If you say something is haram because of this, if that reason goes, does it become halal? You have to say yes. Because your reason of saying haram was because of this. Does that make sense? He said, wa'ura. What about if I had done shower into siyo, naqsiyo? What about if I shower it and I clean it? Wa'ura, it doesn't really matter. Your reason's gone, so your ruling should go with the reason. Huh? Are we all together, brothers? The brother here said germs by kibbutz. There's germs in his system, and that's why it's made haram. What about if they take it to a laboratory, and they scan it, and they put it under radiology, whatever, and they take out everything that's in his system that's bad? Imran haram. إذن دفاك حرام رؤية هيك عبدية إلى أين هو على هذه الشيء؟ الله enslaved us to believe that the dofar is haram. The khamr is already the pig is haram. Allah told us it. We don't know why. We just accept it. Are we all together, brothers? Whether it loses its germs, whether it's cleaned, whether it's stops eating other animals, whether it doesn't eat rubbish or anything, it doesn't matter. Dofar wa haram. إلى يوم القيامة حرام. Are we together, brothers? We don't know your reason, we'll just accept that. The first type of masusa. I just wanted to show you another type which does have no textual evidence and no one can give you a reason for this one. This one we become silent about. But the second type is mustambata. Mustambata halilada. Nabi Mashaykh, waha waha waha. The Prophet didn't say why this is haram. No Mashaykh, why waha halilada. Are we all together, brothers? Shari'a al-harrimi. Nabi ka nama shaykin. Nama di wuhala Allah harrimi. Lakin ulumada they come after. What do they do? The Prophet ﷺ, now he prohibits something and he says something is haram. It's not told to us why it's haram. We don't know why. What the scholars do is they research and they research and they research and they say, yeah, we think we know why it's haram. But there's no textual evidence for it. This is called illa. Mustambata. It was extracted by the scholars. Like this. This hadith, we don't know why we're not allowed to fast 1 or 2 days before Ramadan. The Prophet didn't say anything. Did he say it? Yeah. Nabi Mayri. Nabi Manashari. Nabi Manashari. He didn't say anything. The messenger said, don't fast 1 or 2 days before Ramadan. That's all we know, right? So what is the reason? The reason is the scholars, they looked at it, they thought, they pondered over the hadith, they tried to look at reasons why it could possibly be, and they brought the following reasons. Could they be right? Yes. Could they be wrong? Yes. This is their own ijtihad, their own independent reasoning. سربت الله حرم. The reason why it was made haram is because تمييزوا فرائض العبادات عن نوافلها. They said the reason is because to distinguish the obligatory act from the voluntary act, the supererogatory act. روح على شيخ مش دقيقة من كل عام هذا صفة عروسة هذه وحائلي. The first reason they mentioned is what? إلا كلا سعر. عبادات كواجب كا عبادات كسنة إلا كلا سعر. قف كان بحول سوما مكان. Before Ramadan, what are you doing? Voluntary سوما. Are you not doing voluntary? If 1 or 2 days before Ramadan, if you fast, what's going to happen? سنة يواجب كسنة إلا كلا سعر. Are we looking at that, brothers? If you fast 1 day or 2 days before Ramadan, and then straight away Ramadan comes in, what's going to look like? It's going to look at one obligatory. And it needs to look clear. What is a wajib and what's a sunnah? In a class, I don't know. Saham, what's that? Second, some other scholars, they said, no, that's not the reason. You're confused, you're wrong, there's another reason. The reason is, استعداد لرمضان برغبة ونشاط. رمضان has some better way. رمضان is going to enter. You need to enter رمضان with enthusiasm. You have to be energetic. رمضان أحد السوكان يتولى وحلقات رباء أديق وفرفعون إن رمضان أدشد أدو داريو إنت سوما هي رفات سنو ما أردتين Ramadan Dark in Atiyad Ramadan. Are we together? No. You need to come into Ramadan energetic. Are we together, brothers? I think I want to mention a fourth point, a fourth benefit that we take from the hadith. What is the fourth benefit? The fourth benefit that I want to mention here is that our religion sets boundaries. What is that? تقييد الحدود الشرعية وحكى استحدا لوينا حد وقت قال يسوع على boundaries شريعة everything حدود إلى لا boundaries رمضان واكن شعبان وانمالة رمضان صوم everything is nothing the school خص خص عليه the school ما everything is distinguished are we all together brothers and that's important that you live your life knowing to distinguish one from the other. Second hadith that we're going to go into is عن عبد الله بن عمر رضي الله تعالى عنهما قال سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول إذا رأيتموه فصوموا وإذا رأيتموه فافطروا فإن من عليكم فقدروا له. When you see the crescent,
yeah. Start fasting when you see the crescent, then stop fasting. And
you,
yeah, and if the sky is overcast, complete that one. Huh?
What is one? Pay attention here. MashaAllah, very good. Does everyone here know what the crescent means? Put your hand up if you don't know what crescent means. The crescent means the moon. The moon and the crescent are the same. Crescent muhalagala jayna. The moon can work with some burrid. Because I'm looking at crescent, you know. It's the half moon.
Not full.
Yeah. It's not full. No, it's not full. Moon can work with jamiya. Yeah? Ha, what you should call it. Let me give you the hadith. The people in English had it, let me say in Somali. إِذَا رَأَيْتُمُوهُ مَكَّدْ أَلَكْتَانْ دَيَحَةً Somali. فَصُومُوا صَوْمًا وَإِذَا رَأَيْتُمُوهُ مَكَّدْ أَلَكْتَانْ فَأَفْدِرُوا صَوْمًا It's not Egyptian. Ramadan كُمْ حَدْ كُسُّوا قَشِيمْ دَيَحَةً أَكِيسِ أَلَكْتِنْتَ دَيَحَةً وَبَلَبَّحَ رَمَضَان وَبِشَ رَمَضَان هَذَا مَعْتُوا أَلَكْتِنْتَ دَيَحَةً فإن غم هدين إنك قرش وأرك ويسينا فقدروا له وما عرفتي وقياسا قياسا فقدروا له قياسا وأنا أكيد أنا واحد على جيد هاي the following benefits we take from the hadith فإذا الحديث كجوجته number one وحواجب what is obligatory in song كانوا Salayo. The fasting is based upon what? Rubiyatu hilali, the seed of the crescent. Number intas hasuso. Pay attention. It's the fasting of Ramadan and the obligation of Ramadan is based on the sighting of the moon. And by the sighting of the crescent. So mid the Ramadan, wahaykusaray santa, abayukutayantai, in dayahat larko. Bishr Ramadan, the ending of Ramadan takes place based on the sighting of the moon of the crescent. Bishr Ramadan, the way Kutamata, Araktinta Lakai Daiha. Kutamata. Ramadan Hakatabay, Shawal Samara, Shawal Halakara, Biruyat Hilal. Hadam Israel and Medina, I'm going to ask you guys a question. What did the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam say in the Hadith? إِذَا رَأَيْتُمُوهُ مَكَّدْ أَرَكْتَانُ So what did مَكَّدْ أَرَكْتَانُ Bishop? أَرَكْتِنْتَانْ مَإِنْدَهَانَا With a microscope وَالْوَاكْتَانَ Is the sighting of the moon based on the bare naked eye? Or is it based on the microscope?
Both.
Both in the eye. يا أبي سن إني تحي إشانا فقط Who believes is only the eyes, the naked eye. Who believes is the microscope, only. Who's confused and doesn't know where to go? No. Araktinta, the sight of the moon is based on the naked eye, okay? All of these microscopes, wahala shega, it's got enough.
What if the person have contacts or eyeglass?
And he doesn't count? None of them. That's the naked eye.
That's the naked eye.
Yeah, that's the deficiency of your eyesight. But I don't think a person's glasses can zoom in the right to the present. If you didn't have glasses like that, may Allah bless you. But such the glasses that you have, it doesn't show you that far. Okay? Number two. This hadith negates. This hadith, what does it negate? Negate means eliminate. You know eliminate? Or even a harder word. This hadith, hadith وحوماشة كسارة أو ديديهاي إن بشر غصر يوح السابت. Again, the fasting, this hadith negates, basing the fasting on calculation. Calculation of Hakamid, our brothers and sisters. Calendar and Malahi Susula. These calendar is based on calculation. But look at the Bishwa Ramada based on the calendar. Ramadan's entering and its leaving is not based on a calendar that the Messenger stuck on the wall. No. What is it based upon? When can we say Ramadan came in and when Ramadan left? The sighting of that? The crescent. The sighting of the crescent. Good. Point number three. And this is a consensus. وَقَدْ نَقَلَ شَيْخُ الْإِسْلَامِ إِبْنُ تَيْمِيَةَ And other than إِجْمَعُ الصُّحَابَةَ عَلَى ذَلِكَ The consensus of the companions. Ibn Taymiyyah mentioned that. Are we all together? Because hadith Ibn Huyri, إِلَى رَأِي حَدَّاكَ عَلَكْتَانَ Hadith doesn't say if you counted or calculated. It said if you saw. أَيُوتُمْ إِلَى رَأَيْتُمُوهُ حَدَّاكَ عَلَكْتَانَ مَثَلَتِ رمضان يقول محروس سمعي أركتين. Number three, we couldn't see the present. Point number three that we take from the hadith is إِذَا غُمَّ هِلَالُ رَمَضَانِ وَالْأَكِي وَالْأَيْهِ The present could not be sighted. And 30 days of Sha'ban. The 30 days of Sha'ban. Bishop Rukun Amala, for Islamically, when do we believe it's a month? How many days? There's 2 months for us. 29 and? The month can either be 29 or it can be? 30. It can be any of the two. But actually, on the 29th, what do? It couldn't be seen because of a cloud, because of something. What do we do? The Prophet said, fuck. The Prophet, he said, in another hadith, فَإِنْ غُبِيَ عَلَيْكُمْ فَأَكْمِلُ عِدَّةِ الشَّعْبَانِ ثَلَاثِينَ You couldn't see on the 29th. What do? Complete the 30. Are we all together, brothers and sisters? Pay attention. If on the 29th, the 29th is going to be the day that we can't stop, right? وَلَا فِي فِيلِي وَلَا كَانَ أَدْ وَلَا سُو فِيلِي We're trying to look for it. وَلَا أَكْمِلُ We couldn't see it. What are we going to do? Yeah? We have to finish 30 days. How many do you have to finish? You have to finish the 30 days. And that is what the hadith mentioned. Okay? Number four, right? Point number four. Is it four?
Yeah,
that sighting, does it have to be within the same country? Huh? Does it have to be within the same country? Or is it allowed to be in the same time zone? Okay, pay attention. Somi das. من ودك أجوتي بساعة أركتين تلقى رأيني سواء كان من ساعة دي ودك هدو أما ودك هدو لغسو أركي ما إلا تصونتا عليها رب. Is that a good question? Does everyone understand the question? It was cited in Somalia. They cited it in Somalia. What did they cite in Somalia? The moon got cited. Hey, what are you going to do? Or it got cited in Pakistan. Or in Saudi Arabia. It got cited somewhere. Hey, what do you do? And where? In Helsinki. Helsinki. We are in Finland, Helsinki. Just doesn't sound right. Hel. And Helsinki. Get it? Helsinki. Do you guys know what sinking means?
No.
When the ship sinks. Yeah, that's why I don't like saying it. So in the capital of Finland. Yeah. I look into words too much, huh?
Yeah.
I really do. So, if the country, pay attention, I'm going to answer the question. If the country that you're in has the same time zone as you, when I say time zone is Saudi Arabia and here and Pakistan, and that we share the daytime and the nighttime together. Pakistan day is day for us, night for them, night for us, generally. Maybe 2 hours or 1 hour they might be before us. Like in Australia, in Australia, what's happening? Our brothers there, it's night time, they're sleeping, it's another world. Those people, when they cite it, they have nothing to do with us. Because we are different in time zone. Our time zone is different. Have you in your mind, I'm not sure yet. Yeah? We have nothing to do with each other. The people who citing will change and can tamper with ours is the people who share with us the same time zone. Saudi Arabia, that's what Shaykh is saying. Pakistan, Malaysia is sun. Are we all together? And me personally, I only fast based on Saudi Arabia. I just take their one. The reason why I do it is because they have a reliable, honest, truthful committee. And this, as we're going to see later, is that the citing should be based on what? A reliable person. And then the Somali one, also shared, Allahu A'lam. Not that I don't trust our people, but is there a committee? How do they work? How do they function? Are you with me, brothers? It has to be based on a reliable source. It has to be based on a reliable source. What about if a person sees it and he's in the middle of the ocean? But do kujira. Some brothers have asked, they came from Sweden, right? The brothers that came from Sweden, they told me they're going to be on a boat for 17 hours. As they were on the boat, they saw the moon. They saw the moon, they sighted the moon. One of them woke up and he saw the prison. Are we together, brothers? He looked for the other brothers, he couldn't find them. He could not find the other brothers that he was with because they were sleeping. One was snoring in the car, one was in the bed. Huh? He saw it and he sighted it. Later, he couldn't show them because it became dark. Does he have to fast? He has to fast. Based on the hadith, إِذَا رَأَيْتُمُوهُ فَصُومُوا وَإِذَا رَأَيْتُمُوهُ فَأَفْضِلُوا. He has to fast because he saw it.
What about the friends? Do they help?
Yeah, if he tells them that, and he's a reliable person to them, yes. We're going to talk about that soon, inshallah. Right? At-targhibu fi s-sahur. At-targhibu fi s-sahur. في السحور بفتح السين. عن انس بن مالك رضي الله تعالى عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم تسحروا فان في السحور بركه.
انس بن مالك رضي الله عنه that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said have suhoor for indeed there is a blessing there is a blessing in the suhoor.
Now we're going to go into eating suhoor. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said تسحروا. The Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم تسحروا. What does it mean تسحروا? It means eat at the time of suhoor. عد الوليها قمر خمس قمرين. He said to you, eat suhoor. Okay? This amar, this command of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, does this show obligation? Wajib al fa'il isa. This is amr istihlal, amr irshadi. It's not obligatory. Suhoor is not obligatory. Some scholars believe it, like it's not obligatory. The sahar here is, it's recommended, highly recommended, suhoor, in the Quran. Because the Prophet said, فَإِنَّا فِي السَّحُورِ بَرَكَةً. And the reason why we're saying, السَّحُور is like al-fatur and al-ghasool, bi-fatah. That's the correct way of saying it. Because the sahur, when you place a fatha on it, it means ma yukal, what is eaten. But when you say suhoor, the dhamm is seen. Yeah, it means al-fi'lu, the action. The action is called suhoor, and sahur is what you eat. Wadu, your wudu. Wadu, what is it? It's the place where the water is in. Wudu, the action of it. All of that is important. So here we say, تَسَحَّرُوا فَإِنَّ فِي السَّحُورِ. سَحُورُ وَإِنَّ قُرْبِكَ. You have to place fatah on it. The benefits that we take from this hadith are the following. Number one, that the person will be rewarded. إِلَهِ أَجْرُهُ سِيلَ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى. Allah is going to reward you by coming with suhoor. Allah is going to give you barak. Allah is going to give you, sorry, what did I say? Allah is going to give you barakah in what do you call it? Eating suhoor. And the person who is eating suhoor. Number two, the person who is fasting is commanded to come with suhoor. Is commanded. Not obligatory, but a supererogatory manner. Supererogative means what? Does anyone know what supererogatory means? Yeah? Well, it's something that's voluntary. Do you know what voluntary means? That which is not obligatory on you. You don't have to do it. مستحب وها أم مندوب أن الصائم مأمور بالسحور. That the fasting is, the one who's fasting is commanded to come with سحور out of recommendation. It's not obligatory. قسم معه. What was the second one? The first one I mentioned? Barakah. I forgot to mention the barakah here is two barakah. Barakah dunyawiyya, worldly barakah. And akhira barakah. Both of them you're going to get. Suhoor kalawah carries on. How is there barakah in the dunya? How is the barakah in the dunya? Sawr mu'atin. That's all wrong. Who eats sawr for suhoor? You eat it. Sawr is something I can never eat. I hate it to pieces. I hate it, wallahi. Sawr is, okay, let me tell you sawr. Would you be with sawr in English? It's like wheat. Oh, no, it's not. Well, there's an English word for it, man. I forgot. All I have to tell you, though, is anyone who has sawr, I promise you, all day he will look at you like he's just eating iftar right now. People have suhoor are strong, they're doing everything. If you have suhoor with sorb, and another food that I hate this dish, but I'm bored of it. Who does Abula Buyada? He's there, I don't know if you're sure of that. Abula is black, you call it. It's black beans. It's not even about the beans, it's how they cook it every day. It's not that, yeah. Well, anyways, Ula, Ula, Ula. Abula Ula, Sarna Ula, Ivi, yeah. And that would teach you how I all day you're strong. All day you're what? Number three, the hadith does not state and it doesn't mention what type of food you have to eat. I mean the food that you eat. That means you're allowed to eat whatever you want. مهم أنتاس لا يختص بطعام معين أنت specific what you're doing. Another thing that we take from the hadith is والله مراعاة الشريعة كمال الشريعة الإسلامية في مراعاة العدل. Look how just our religion is. إلهي Allah is so caring, so just and kind to us that He's telling us eat before iftar. We're all together. I mean, sorry, eat before fasting. Eat before it. That's a that the religion really cares about us and is concerned about us. Number five is brothers and sisters, pay attention. Four. Maya. I mentioned three, four brothers. Well, I mentioned that. The first one I mentioned is that the fasting has what? Baraka. Second was what? The commandment to fast. And the third was what?
Which kind of food?
There's no specific food for suhoor. The fourth one is how just our religion is, right? Is it because you want me to mention numbers?
Yeah.
Okay. Let me repeat it one more time. The first one was what? Yeah? The barakah in the fasting. But this barakah is what? Diniya and dunyawiya. Religious benefit, akhirah benefit, and dunya benefits. Okay. Yes, those two benefits. The second benefit that I mentioned from the hadith is what? That you are commanded, but not in a forceful manner, in a recommended manner, that you are told to fast. Number three is what? There's no specific food to eat for suhoor. Number four is our religion. One of it, that this religion is complete. That it's a religion that really serves our lifestyle. Deen tanfiriyah, yeah? It is your whole entire lifestyle. Your whole life. Deen ta ma'a masajid bisubu ikiyayyo. Ma'at Christianity, adopt 316. Christianity is all built on what? You just come to the church, that's when you remember God. So man, as soon as you go out, you're not doing anything. Islam is not like that. Islam goes in every place of your life. So it's a whole entire lifestyle. It is a what? It's a lifestyle that takes care of how you are. Number five, and I want you to ponder on this. The fifth one, kishala. Ma'aritai, husnul ta'aleem in Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Look how the good way that the Messenger was teaching us. Nabi qabku nabiku hadlai fir sallam, brothers and sisters. Nabi yassiduku hadlai hadab, but a tip, you will learn how to talk. If you look at the way the Prophet used to speak, you will learn how to talk to people. What did the Prophet do? The Prophet ﷺ mentioned to come with what? Suhoor. Huyni. What suhoor tabalino? Kitim huur ra'siye. What did he follow it up with? When he said do suhoor? Benefit kinu shayro. He mentioned the benefit. Qaf baka la'alli sinu wahir rutina ushayki. Wuliya lilobi ila wa benefit kuj rutina ushayki. We go together. If you want to tell somebody something you think they should do, tell them the benefit that is in it. حتى ها سامير ما حد عارف تقارنا بشكل. Yeah, that's what I mean. It's very important. هاي الحديث هذا. هاي. That's the hadith right now. Now we're going to go there. عن أنس بن مالك عن زيد بن ثابت رضي الله تعالى عنهما قال تسحرنا مع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ثم قام إلى الصلاة قال أنس قلت لزيد كم كان بين الأذان والسحور قال قدر 50 آية.
Zayd ibn Thabit radiallahu anhuma, we have suhoor with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then he stood for the prayer. And I said to Zayd, how much was between the adhan and the suhoor? He said, equivalent to the time it takes to read 50 verses.
This hadith, the benefit that we take from it is that suhoor is legislated, number one. That the suhoor is what? It's something legislated in our sharia. Write this down. And delaying it is also legislated in our sharia. Suhoor ta wa shay mashru'a. Din tena lu shari'iyye, din tena lu ogalalay. Suhoor ta din tena kamita sabad. Yeah? Suhoor ta is part of our religion. Divine or Diga. Suhoor to Mahal Sumina. What do you do to the Suhoor? Divine or Diga. Dip? Delay it. So you delay the Suhoor close to what? Close to the Fajr. Very close to the Fajr. Why is that? Hifdu Quwwa al-Badan. The reason is because you want to. You need to look after your body, right? The more you are closer to the Fajr, the more you are what? The closer you are to the Fajr, the longer you can last in your fasting, right? The longer you can last in the fasting. The question is second point. The second point is the duration. You all know what a duration is? Yeah? Duration, yeah. Who knows what duration means? Duration is the time span. Does anyone here know time span or time span? Does anyone know here length? It's the duration. Mudala ula haisa. Suhurti ya fajr kam hawaya. Qira'atu 50 ayah. It's the recitation of 50 verses. Between the suhur and the fajr is what? The recitation of how many verses? Kontak ayahot ahim tiyadawa. بلا فهم من سوق سرعة شاب سرعة شاب the duration وقت يقول أحيو مدة يقول أحيسو the duration between فجر and the سحور from when you should eat سحور until فجر is how many ayahs they can read content ayah 50 verses meaning when you eat the سحور and you finish then 50 verses should be read, and the Fajr should come in. You get it? قفوا عاخدا يبتان بي والتروي ترتيب الله عاخدا ما عندنا عاخد الله عبد العالمين عمر عبد العالمين فقط ترتيب هو عاخده يا he's reciting he's giving every word it's right لكن باع على سيدي لما كان مساعدة قارب البودي تشاهد وآلا يصعوه ما عندنا فكا مجوة بعد one that is quite for a little bit. And what do you think? No. It means that the person is reading like, you know how Hussein really, you know what you mean.